Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on the topic of discrete-time Markov chain. So today's video is the last one that will cover the actual theory of Markov chains. I will give you a few more videos after to give you examples of applications of what we are going to do today. So about the theory, what we know so far is that you have different representations of a Markov chain in terms of the transition matrix or directed graph. From that you can compute multi-step transition probabilities, or you can find the communication classes of a Markov chain. We saw also other important notions that are positive recurrence, null recurrence, recurrence in general, or transients. And about the convergence theory, what we've learned in the previous video about really the theory of Markov chain is that if you have an irreducible Markov chain, then this process is going to be positive recurrent if and only if there is a unique stationary distribution. So in this case, in case of positive recurrence, then we also know that the fraction of time spent in a state in the long run is going to converge to the corresponding coefficient of the stationary distribution. And we also know that the mean recurrence time at a state is equal to 1 divided by, the corresponding coefficients of the stationary distribution. So now the last thing we need to do is to study also the convergence of the multi-step transition probabilities that we defined at the very beginning. So we saw that the PNXY are extremely difficult to compute, even if we have a way to compute them in theory. Looking at the nth power of the transition matrix, it can be very difficult in practice, but it turns out that again, the limit of those multi-step transition probabilities are going to be equal to the corresponding coefficients of the stationary distribution. So what I'm saying is that PNXY is going to converge to PiY, but it's not always the case that we have convergence. So what I'm saying is that if we have convergence, then we indeed converge to this value. But now, what we are going to do today is study the convergence theory for those multi-step transition probabilities. And we'll see that to have indeed convergence of those objects, we need one more ingredient in addition to irreducibility and positive recurrence. We also need something called aperiodicity. So here is the plan I'm going to follow. First, I'm going to talk about the period of a state. I'm going to define this notion of period of a state, and we'll prove also that exactly same as transients, recurrence, null recurrence, or positive recurrence, the period is also a class property, so all states in the same communication class should all have the same period, which allows us to define this notion of aperiodic Markov chain, so that's irreducible Markov chain for which all the states have period 1. And then we'll see that under this condition, all states have period 1 and the process is irreducible. We'll see that under those conditions, we have convergence of the limiting probabilities, of the multi-step probabilities, and we get something that we call the limiting probabilities. And I will show you that in the proof relies on the beautiful coupling argument, something called coupling argument due to Doeblin. So first, let's define the notion of period of a state in the Markov chain. So definition, the period of a state, let's say X, in the state space is defined as something I'm going to call D of X, and it's going to be equal to the GCD. So GCD stands for greatest common divisor of all the, let's say, K strictly positive such that PK XX is strictly positive. So, concretely, to find the period of a state, if you have a Markov chain, and I'm going to give you an example of illustration of that after, in another video. So, you don't want to use the transition matrix, you want to use instead the directed graph. So if you look at all the possible paths that go from x to x, so you have infinitely many, typically. You have infinitely many, but you have only a finite number of such paths that are, we say, self-evolving, meaning that if you take a path, maybe the path can come back to itself, and if you remove all the loops, you still get a path that has positive probability. So to find a period, what you do concretely is you find all the possible directed paths in your directed graph representation going from x to x, but with no loop, and you should have a finite number of such paths that gives you a set of numbers and a set of k such that pk xx is strictly positive, and then you can take the GCD of all these numbers, and that gives you the period of a state. So you have to be careful that it's possible that pxx is equal to zero. So notice that if pxx is strictly positive, then one is in this set, and so the GCD is going to be one. So the state has period one. Now, if one is not in this state, meaning pxx in this set, meaning that pxx is equal to zero, this does not mean that the period of x is equal to is strictly larger than one. Sorry. Example: if you can go from x to x in, like, let's say, three steps or in five steps, then because the GCD of three and five is equal to one, then the period is still going to be one. Okay. So that defines the notion of period. And the main result, the main first result about period, is the fact that the period is a class property. So exactly the same idea as for recurrence, transience, positive recurrence, null recurrence. So the period is a class property. So again, this means that if two elements are in the same communication class, then they must have the same period. This also means that if your process xn is irreducible, and then you have only one communication class, then all the state must have the same period. And then we don't talk about the period of a state anymore. We talk about the period of the Markov chain itself. Okay. So how do we prove this? So the proof is just some basic tricks using arithmetic, like some easy number theory. So to prove the result, clearly, if we understand the statement like logically, the goal is to take two state x and y in the same communication class, so two states that communicate, and then we want to prove that dx is equal to dy. Okay? So if we assume that x and y communicate, then this means that there exist n, m. If x and y are equal, then n and m equals 0 are going to work, but then there is nothing to prove, because if x and y are equal, then they have the same period. So we are going to assume that x and y are different, in which case we need n and m strictly positive, such that pn xy is strictly positive and pn yx is strictly positive. Okay, now that we have those two integers, what we are going to do is show, see that for all k such that pk xx or yy, it doesn't matter, let's take pk yy, strictly positive. So I'm going to take any integer such that pk yy is strictly positive, meaning that k is in this set here, okay, is in this set here for y instead of x. So for all k such that pk yy is positive, what we are going to have, it's again by using Chapman-Kolmogorov's inequality, I can tell that first from this one, we can say that Pn plus M xx. So we know that if you condition on anything that can happen at time n, so using Chapman-Kolmogorov, this is equal to the sum over z, let's say, of pnxz times pmzy. If I take the particular case z equals y and I extract this single term from the sum, I obtain that the sum is larger than this specific term. And so pn, here we have that this is larger than pnxy times pmyx. But by assumption, those two multi-step transition probabilities are positive, so the product is strictly positive. Same story if I inject k in the story, so we are going to have pn plus k plus m, xx is going to be larger or equal. Now I do two conditioning, one at time n, one at time n plus k. I use Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation twice, and then we get that this is larger than pn xy times pk yy, and that's the reason I plot here with k. It's because we know that the pk yy is strictly positive, and times pn yx. So again, those two terms, like before, they are strictly positive, and this one is also strictly positive by assumption. We choose k such that pkyy is strictly positive, so this one is also strictly positive. So what we prove so far is for any k in this set here, but for x equals y, then we have that those two multi-step transition probabilities are strictly positive. And so from this, we can deduce our result. So now I'm going to use some basic arithmetic. By definition of the period, because pn plus m xx is strictly positive, that means that n plus m is in the set of k prime such that pk prime xx is strictly positive. So that means that the period of x, d of x, should divide this number. Okay? So from this we deduce that dx divides n plus m, and for the same reason, dx also divides n plus k plus m. But then this means that those two numbers can be written as multiples of d of x, and so the difference between the two numbers, which is k, is again a multiple of d of x, so that means that dx also divides k. So we deduce that d of x divides k. And that almost completes our proof. If we start from the beginning here, we see that dx divides k for all k such that pk yy is strictly positive. But it turns out that, again, by definition of the period, d of y, the period of y, is the largest number that divides all these, all such k's, okay? That's the greatest common divisor. So d of y is the largest possible integer that divides all such k's. But d of x also divides all such k's. And so from this, we can deduce that d of x must be less or equal to d of y. So we have this inequality. You see that the statement here is completely symmetric. We just take two states x and y in the same communication class, and then by this reasoning we can prove that the period of x should be less or equal to the period of y. By symmetry we also have that the period of y should be less or equal to the period of x. So we conclude that from this inequality and by symmetry we have also the reverse inequality. And so we deduce that d of x is equal to d of y. So this shows indeed that the period is a communication, not a communication class, it's a class properly, meaning that if two states are in the same communication class, then they must have the same period. So now I'm going to state the last important theorem I'm going to prove in those videos. And so the theorem says the following. It's about the limiting probabilities this time instead of fraction of time spent in a state. So it says that if the process is irreducible, so if you have irreducibility plus positive recurrence, and also aperiodicity, so what I mean by aperiodicity is the fact that all the elements have period 1. Notice that irreducibility and positive recurrence imply that there is a unique stationary distribution pi. And the theorem we just proved, which states that, that the period is a class properly, tells us that if you have irreducibility and so one communication class only, all the states should have the same period. So aperiodicity means that the Markov chain itself, because it's recurrent, is attributed a unique number corresponding to the period of all states. And aperiodicity means that this Markov chain has period 1. So if you have those three ingredients, then you can conclude that. So from the first two, we have existence and uniqueness of the stationary distribution. From aperiodicity, we can also deduce that Pn xy is going to converge to pi y. So same conclusion as for the fraction of time spent in a state. That's the limit when n goes to infinity. And notice that the limit depends on y, of course, but does not depend on x. So that's independent of the initial state. So how do we prove this? There is a proof using Perron-Frobenius theorem, but that's something in linear algebra, and because I'm a probabilist, I'm going to give you another type of argument that is very useful and very beautiful, in fact, in probability theory. It's based on what we call a coupling argument. And this argument consists in constructing several random variables or several stochastic processes on the same probability space in order to compare them. So, the idea is basically going to be to call, let's say, xn and yn, two copies, two independent copies of our Markov chain. So these are two independent copies of our Markov chain. So what this means is that independence is already defined, they move independently, they co-evolve independently, but copies means that they are equal in distribution, they just define the same two Markov chains. So in particular, they have the same transition probabilities. Okay? So they both have the same transition probabilities, but they move, they evolve independently. And the goal is to study the new process Zn, which is equal to Xn, Yn. Okay? It turns out that obviously this process is again a Markov chain. But it's not clear whether the process is recurrent, positive recurrent, irreducible, and so on. So the goal is to study this one, and the idea of the proof is the following. Eventually, I'm going to assume that here you have the evolution of xn, and here you have yn. So the process zn now has state space S squared. and evolve in this square here, S cross S. And the goal is to prove that no matter the original position of the process Zn, eventually the process is going to hit the diagonal. Okay? Diagonal is defined as the set of xy such that x is equal to y. And so at this time, and the goal is to prove that this time is almost surely finite, at this time, those two coordinates are going to be equal. And because xn and yn have the same transition probabilities, after that time, they are going to co-evolve again independently. They won't be equal almost surely, but they will be equal in this direction. And that's the trick to prove that that the limiting behavior of the process does not depend on the initial state or on the initial distortion. And that's the key argument that will make, that will show the theorem. So to prove this, we need to prove a few things. There are different steps to prove. The first one is more a trick about arithmetic, so I'm not going to go too much into the details. I'm mostly going to insist on the probability aspect, and we are not going to spend too much time justifying the arithmetic. So step one is to prove that there exists an integer k, which is finite but probably very large, such that p little k xx is strictly positive for all k larger than capital K. So what this says is that, and notice that my pkxx is only the k-step transition probabilities attached to the process xn or yn, so I'm not talking about zn right now, I'm only talking about the process xn. So that's a new property that we have that states that if a process is aperiodic, so that's the main ingredient here is going to be aperiodicity. If the process is aperiodic, then after some large enough time, then all the possible times after that are good enough for x to return to itself. Okay, so. So the idea is the following. So because of aperiodicity, okay, we deduce that there exist n and n such that pn xx is positive, pn xx is also positive, but those two numbers are mutually prime. So I'm going to write that those two ones belong to a set, maybe I can write below, implies that there exist n and n, both in the set Ix, that is defined as the set of k strictly positive such that pk xx is strictly positive. So, by definition of the period of x is exactly the GCD of the numbers in Ix, it's the GCD of Ix, and because this GCD is equal to 1, that's the definition of aperiodicity, this means that I can indeed find two integers in this set such that n and m are mutually prime, so that means such that the GCD of n and m is equal to 1. Okay? Then, from that, we use an important result in arithmetic called Bezout identity. And so this result tells us that if the GCD of two numbers is equal to 1, then we can find two integers, let's say a and b, such that a n plus b m is equal to 1. So this gives us there exist a and b such that An plus Bm is equal to A. Okay? And so that's the first step to prove point one here. And the second ingredient we need, it's again a consequence of Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation. So by Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation, we have that this set Ix is stable for the sum. For plus, let's say. So, what do I mean by that? Well, I mean that if k and k prime are in Ix, then k plus k prime is again in Ix. That follows again from those equations that we use many times. Indeed, if k and k prime are in Ix, then p k plus k prime of xx is larger than p k xx times p k prime xx, that are both positive. So that's again p k plus k prime xx is again positive. So k plus k prime is in Ix. That follows from Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation. And using those two ingredients, and I'm not going to give the details here, but you can show that if you choose k sufficiently large, then eventually at any of the following integer is going to be in this set. Okay, so that's using this. This is equal to 1, and n and m are both in Ix. And this one, we know that Ix is stable for the sum. And so eventually, combining those two ingredients, you can indeed prove that if for all k sufficiently large, then for all k in Ix sufficiently large, k plus 1 is also in Ix. And then by induction, you get that all the integers after some fixed integer k are going to be in Ix. So that shows the first step of the proof. Now, second step to prove this, the second step is about the process Zn. So I'm going to briefly remind you that Zn is this vector xn yn. So now we know that Zn, which is defined as this vector of two independent copies of our Markov chain, is irreducible. So the fact that this process Zn is irreducible follows from the fact that the two components here are irreducible, but also from this result here. Okay? So here to prove this, what I need to do, using the fact that two state communicate is symmetric, I only need to prove that if I take xy and x prime y prime in S square, which is the state space of Zn, then I can indeed go from xy to x prime y prime. So I'm going to fix xy and x prime y prime in the state space of Zn, which is S square. And then by irreducibility, not irreducibility of Zn, that's what we want to prove, but by irreducibility of the two components, we know that there exist n, m positive, such that p n x x prime is strictly positive, and Pm y y prime is strictly positive. So now I'm going to go from this state to this state for the process Zn in n plus m plus k steps, and k is going to be such that k is larger than capital K. And so now that we have those two elements, so I'm going to use another notation so that we have no confusion between the transition probabilities for xn, yn that are the same, and the one for zn that are different. And so for the n step transition probabilities for the process zn, I'm going to use a p bar. So p bar of n plus m plus k of, now we want to go from xy to x prime y prime. Okay, so by definition of the process zn, and because xn and yn are independent, the probability of going from this one in, let's say, t time step is exactly the probability that xn goes to from x to x prime and y goes from y to y prime in t time step. But because the two processes here are assumed to be independent, this transition probability is just the product of the transition probabilities for xn and yn. And so this is equal to pn plus m plus k x x prime times pn plus m plus k y y prime. And now I can again use Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation to condition on all the possible intermediate state for here, and break down each of the term here into a product of two terms, but I'm going to have an inequality instead. So now this is larger than Pn, so we know that Pn xx prime is strictly positive, so I'm going to use this one. So we have Pn x x prime, then that's, this term is larger than this times the Pn plus k x prime, and then same story for the second term. I'm going to say that it's larger than Pm this time, because we chose m such that y prime is positive, so y prime, and then I still have a Pn plus k, and then I need y prime. Okay, so we know that Pn xx prime is positive, so this term is positive, Pn yy prime is positive. Okay, so we recognize those terms here, and then for those two ones, we just use step one and say that, well, if k is large enough, so of course I want to prove that this is positive for a large enough k, that's not true for all k. But indeed, if k is large enough, because we have pkxx positive for all x, then we have that for k large enough, this is positive and this is positive, and eventually the whole thing is positive. So that shows indeed that from, if I take any two states in the new state space S squared, then the process Zn can indeed go from this first state to this second one in a finite number of steps, and this shows that the process Zn is irreducible. So now, first step, maybe I can erase step one, we don't need it anymore. The first step is to prove that the process Zn is also positive recurrent, and with what we proved last time, this step is in fact very easy. Okay, so step three, and maybe I should remind you at the same time step two. So Zn, which is equal to again xn yn, we already know that this is irreducible. Notice that the fact that it's irreducible follows from the fact that each of those two components here are aperiodic, and it turns out that it's also positive recurrent. So So positive recurrence is easy to prove. You just observe that. So the proof of that is easy. It just follows from the fact that, let's say pi bar xy, if you define this new measure, so now that's a measure defined on the Cartesian product S cross S, this equals pi x, pi y, okay, we know that this is going to define a stationary distortion. Okay, and but then we know that for an irreducible process, existence of a stationary distortion is equivalent to existence and uniqueness of a stationary distortion is equivalent to positive recurrence. So that shows that indeed this process here is going to be a positive recurrence. So that's simple. And now that we know this, we can conclude. So notice that here, yeah, this thing is kind of obvious, and again, that follows from the fact that xn and yn are independent. So so that means that, yeah, if pi is an equilibrium, a common equilibrium for xn and yn, then it's clear that that this new object is going to be indeed an equilibrium, a stationary distortion for xn, comma yn, so the process zn. So we have this, and now we have this main result here. That's the first step of the proof. I mean, now that we have this, we can conclude. So how do we conclude? I'm just going to draw a picture to start. Now we have so the process xn here and yn here. This is S square. And then again, I'm going to draw this diagonal. I'm going to call this diagonal delta. And we saw that the goal was kind of to prove that if we start, no matter what's the initial state of xn and yn, eventually they will converge toward each other and they will have the same distortion. And so this kind of shows some independence in the initial state or initial distortion. And so to do this, I'm going to call t the first time n at which the two processes are equal. So, or let's say Zn belongs to delta, okay? Delta is defined as the set of xy in S square such that x equals y. So I'm looking at this time. Of course, it's equal by definition of the process Zn to the infimum of n such that xn is equal to yn. Okay? Now, because we know that that this process Zn is irreducible and positive recurrent, okay? That means that irreducibility means that that the diagonal can be reached from any initial state. Okay, so that's possible for the process Zn to reach the diagonal, and that's going to do it in a finite time, even in expected value, because the process is positive recurrent. So that means that if I take any state along the diagonal, the time it takes for the process Zn to reach this state is going to be almost surely finite, and even the expected value is finite. Okay, so we can deduce that expected value of t is finite. In fact, I'm just going to write that this one is finite with probability 1. And then I skip a little bit of algebra, but this implies that eventually, again, because those two processes, they have the same transition probabilities, so eventually they will be equal to each other. And after time t, the distribution of xn and the distribution of xn and yn should be the same. Okay, and so from that we deduce that by finiteness of t, that the probability that yn equals y minus the probability that xn equals y, so I'm comparing a similar object but for xn and yn, this thing should converge to zero as n goes to infinity. Okay? Again, this is due to the fact that after a finite amount of time t, xn and yn are equal, and because they have the same transition probabilities, after that time, xn and yn are equal in distribution. So this means that after time t, those two quantities are equal, but I only have convergence to zero and not equal to zero starting from a fixed time, because I still have a random time here t, but because t is almost surely finite, we have this convergence. And and then the last step is just to assume, so maybe I can erase here, no? Now that's everything we need to know. The last step is going to take particular choices for x0 and y0. So now assume that x0 is equal to x. So why am I taking x0 equals x? Is so that this term is in fact equal to the pnxy. But then I'm going to also assume that instead of having yn starting from a specific state, I'm going to assume that yn starts from the unique stationary distribution of the process. So I'm going to write just that y0 till pi like this. I'm using this notation just to say that the probability that y0 is equal to x is equal to pi x. And so from this, it turns out that this absolute value here, I can rewrite it. So the probability that yn equals y minus the probability that xn equals y. Okay? So this one we said, it's exactly, because x0 is equal to x, it's exactly pnxy. But this one, because we start at stationarity, I can add this here, in fact, we know by definition of the stationary distribution that this is going to be equal to pi y for all n. And so this is equal to pi y minus pnxy. And we know from here that this goes to zero. And so this indeed implies that pnxy converges to pi y. Okay? So again, we have our conclusion, irreducibility, positive recurrence and aperiodicity. All three together are going to give you the existence and uniqueness of a stationary distribution. And now we know that also the multi-step transition probabilities or limiting probabilities are going to converge to pi y in this case. And and so that concludes the proof. So in the next videos, I'm going to give you example of applications of this theorem, but I'm also going to do other videos where I show you in concrete examples how we can compute using the directed graph representation the period of an irreducible Markov chain. And by looking at example in which the period is not equal to 1, I will at the same time show you that in fact this convergence is not true, or at least is not always true, if the period is not equal to 1.